Здравствуйте.
О!
Как выживаете?
Нормально?
Так, сын.
Нормально, да?
Хорошо.
Хорошо. Это севернокорейский, да?
Да, это.
Севернокорейский, да?
Да, севернокорейский.
Вот, да, уже пришел.
Саран, саран, не саран, 그대 모습 꽃인가, 꽃보다 더 예쁜 내 사랑이야. 단오명절 그 봄날에
In 1937, Joseph Stalin signed a decree to deport every ethnic Korean living in Far East Soviet Russia, 4,000 miles away to the steppes of Central Asia. They called themselves Koryo Saram. Stalin called them the Unreliable People. I first visited Kazakhstan in 1995, shortly after the country gained independence from the Soviet Union. It is a stunningly beautiful country with high mountains and vast regions of rolling steppe. For centuries, nomadic Kazakh people have roamed these lands, tending to their livestock. Stretching from Siberia to China in the east, and to the Caucasus in the west, it is the ninth largest country in the world. It is also one of the least populated areas on the planet. Walking the streets of the largest city, Almaty, I saw a bewildering array of people of all nationalities. As a Korean American, I was used to the diversity of the West. Here I was seeing a different mix. Ukrainians, Uzbeks, Germans, Crimean Tatars, Uyghurs. I started to meet Korean people as well. Koreans who spoke Russian. At first I thought these Koreans were recent arrivals, but soon learned that their families had been there for three generations. They call themselves Koryo Saram, which means Korean person in a dialect no longer spoken in modern South Korea. I discovered people who were born in the same towns in North Korea as my parents. Had my ancestors fled by a different route, their story might have been my own.
Поэтому мы так мучились. Нас везли, 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 говорит. Даже Алмату проехали, говорит. Негде разгружать, пустыни не осталось уже.
Конечно, обидно. Не знаешь языка, нету языка. Это уже не нация, я считаю, национальность. Вот потеряли.
Я думаю, что трагедию 37-го года мы расхлебываем до конца, честно говоря. Это, так сказать, Сталин в 37-м году заложил мину замедленного действия, и она сейчас, как бы сказать, больше и больше как бы дает.
Герман Ким, a professor at the Kazakh National University, has devoted his career to researching the Korean diaspora and the roots of his people, the Koryo Saram.
Our history starts from the Russian Far East, where my parents were born. Korea was struck by a famine, and the people were starving. And so they moved to Russia, because in Russia was a better condition for agriculture.
In desperation, people poured over the northern border into Far Eastern Russia. It started in 1863. That was the first official record of the Russian border officers that 13 Korean families applied for permission to settle down. The refugees were mostly peasants, and they brought with them only the packs on their backs and the customs of their rural villages. These traditional ways would merge into the unique culture of the Koryo Saram. They settled around the frontier provinces of Primorsky and Khabarovsk, farming, fishing, and providing labor for the Russian railroads and the port city of Vladivostok. Major events at the dawn of the 20th century would transform the lives of the Koryo Saram again. In 1905, the Japanese defeated the Russian Navy, paving the way to the protectorate over Korea. By 1910, Japan had annexed Korea as a colony. Rather than live under the Japanese, many Koreans left their homeland, swelling the communities in the Russian Far East. These new immigrants to Russia now found themselves swept up in another great event, the Bolshevik Revolution. The Bolsheviks proclaimed what? Equality, peace, and land for peasants. But who relocated to the Russian Far East? Naturally, only the poorest Korean peasants. And these ideas of equality, fraternity, and of land transfer to those who farm it, of course, couldn't fail to attract large sections of the Korean community. Several thousand Koreans fought in partisan detachments against the Japanese aggression. They fought with the Red Army, thinking that this would lead to the liberation of Korea from Japan. After the October Revolution in 1917, the Koreans in Far East Russia were gradually integrated into the Soviet system. They actively took part in the Communist Party and Soviet institutions. A Korean language newspaper, theater, and schools were established. By the 1930s, 180,000 Koreans lived in Far East Soviet Russia.
Родилась в 1923 году в городе Владивостоке. В памяти у меня от детства остались очень хорошие воспоминания. Что касается чисто бытовой жизни в семье, вот я сейчас вспоминаю, семья у нас большая была, очень большая. У нас пятеро детей, две тетки жили, няня жила.
Декабрина Ким now lives in a Soviet-era apartment in Kazakhstan. She was eager to share her memories of the Far East with her American guests. Her mother was a school teacher, and her father a leading local party official. They were pillars of the community.
И постоянно был люд у нас. Приходили политические деятели, революционеры, корейцы. И ходили они вот в белом во всем. И тетка моя их называла лебеди за это.
By the 1930s, Korean leaders were rising through the ranks of the regional Communist Party. Principal among them was Декабрина's father, Михаил Ким.
Мой отец трижды встречался со Сталиным. На этой фотографии он сидит рядом со Сталиным. Это происходило на 17-м партийном, всесоюзном партийном съезде ВКПБ. Это происходило в ноябре 1934 году. А мой отец был делегатом на этот всесоюзный съезд из Хабаровского крайкома коммунистической партии.
Nearly all of the delegates to this Congress were later executed in a purge engineered by Stalin. Mikhail Kim was also executed, accused of spying for the Japanese. Stalin had implemented a program of purges, which became known as the Great Terror. The Soviet regime presented one image to the world of ethnic harmony and acceptance, while they controlled nationalities within their borders by whatever means necessary. In 1931, the Japanese occupied Manchuria. This was followed by increasing skirmishes between the Soviet and Japanese armies along the Soviet border. In July 1937, the Japanese invaded China. Stalin came to fear an attack on the Soviet Union itself. He viewed the 180,000 Koreans living in the Soviet Far East as potential enemy collaborators, based solely on their race.
Наступил 37-й год. Вы знаете, довольно внезапно, в начале сентября вдруг из НКВД пришли два, я вот сейчас помню, высокие люди, мужчины среднего возраста и сказали: через два дня готовьтесь к отъезду, берите все самое необходимое.
Ну, чего делали? В 1937 году моих родителей, отца, старшего брата, они забрали и расстреляли. Ну, мы остались семья. И нас выгнали из дома и дали срок 3 дня на улице жить. Нам ничего не давали, имущество ничего не давало. У нас было кое-что много отцовое, там и спот было, и то, тут все отобрали и ничего не давали. И на третий день нас погрузили в грузовой машине и привезли в станцию Раздольную.
Вопросы, куда, зачем, никаких вопросов сказали. И когда нас погрузили в один из товарных вагонов, это грязище, вы знаете, вот эти деревянные вот перегородки, видно, скот везли и перегораживали там что-то. Товарные вагоны, в которых перевозят скот.
Китая, кидане, кутумсундерранг, шилпу, деньги, 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 деньги.
А взрослые начали переустраивать, надо как-то что-то делать, спать на чем-то. И вот сейчас я вспоминаю тетки, вот это гребли и сено, и солому оттуда, и что-то вот устраивали для того, чтобы хотя бы ночь провести.
저대로 어쩌는가 음식을 바로 먹지 못하게 됐었지. 어쩌는가 임석을 그릴 데가 없지. 거기서 이동해서 떠나 들어올 때 노인들, 아르니들 있었지. 그들이 어쩌는가 길에서 세상을 떠나게 됐습니다.
바다로기 масса, масса людей умирала. Вы знаете, вот слышишь, в соседнем вагоне рыдают, плачут дети, грудные, старые, пожилые, молодые. И им даже на захоронение не давали ведь время.
Роддом, то, что родильное отделение, то, что не женщина рождает ребенок, тоже видели, умирали. Если умирает на следующей остановке, вот это станции остановили, их оставили все родственники, где похоронили, даже не знаю. Вот такое я хорошо помню.
In Korean culture, the dead who are not buried are considered restless spirits, doomed to roam the earth. This is why the Koryo Saram called their transport the ghost trains. The memory still haunts them. After 1 month and 4,000 miles, the trains had reached Central Asia, which was to be the final destination for the Koreans. The survivors of the journey were scattered throughout the region, 100,000 in Kazakhstan and 80,000 in Uzbekistan. Arrivals were put into empty warehouses, prisons, barns, and those were the lucky ones. 34,000 Koreans were deposited here, in Ushtobi, a small outpost in the vast steppe. Due to a lack of available shelter, many thousands were left to survive the first 2 winters in the open steppe.
Но уже вещи в этот тупик загнали. Вот это эшелон, но это уже ваш конец, но сами вынуждены высадить, надо помочь. Выходили. Сами каждый выкопали землянку, там корейский ондорди, ондо. Кругу топили из камыша, деревья, дерево, уголь, понятия не имели. 2-3 года жил, потом война начала, опять плохо.
This hillside provided the only shelter from the winds of the desolate steppe. It was a difference between life and death. Today, it still holds almost religious significance to the Koryo Saram. Thousands died of starvation, sickness, and exposure. They froze to death. Far more people died here than on the trip itself. There was no chance of survival for the very young and very old, or for those the Soviet regime had marked down as least trustworthy. Those under greatest suspicion were dispersed far away from one another for further punishment. This included the family of Dekabina Kim.
Маму и нас, троих детей, мы, вы понимаете, вдвойне пострадали, как депортированная нация и как семья врага народа, сильные. Нас послали из Бугуцальского района за 200 километров. Когда мы приехали туда, ну теперь я понимаю, это было отгонное животноводство. Жила всего одна семья. Чабан – мужчина, его жена и, ну, мальчик, может быть, лет 8. Ни жилья, ничего. Вы можете представить, мама еще молодая, нас трое детей, не приспособленная к такой жизни. Они нам предоставили юрту свою, а сами, значит, ушли в какую-то хибару. И вот эта семья практически кормила нас. Вот эта семья. Так вы понимаете, что это удивительные были люди благородные. Тогда ведь все боялись, если ты сильный.
The traditional Kazakh family built yurts, their signature round dwellings, and moved with their flocks to provide new seasonal pastures for the animals. The Kazakhs were known for the generosity of their welcome to fellow travelers, sharing what little they had even with complete strangers. This tradition saved countless Korean lives. But it was a culture the Soviets had already tried to break, with terrible consequences. The Soviet plan was to turn this desolate land into a bountiful agricultural engine. The nomads were forced to settle on collective farms. Many resisted by killing their livestock rather than surrender them to the state. Other animals, now confined to the farms, fell victim to disease and starvation. A devastating famine struck the Kazakh population. The Koreans, cleansed from the Soviet Far East by Stalin's order, now found themselves in an area plagued by food shortages, lack of housing, and little water. Joseph Stalin left the Koreans with only this, a mandate to grow rice. At the Ushtobi market, amidst a stall selling Korean kimchi, Kurdish bread, and Kazakh meats, I found Mikhail Chun doing his shopping. The Koryo Saram were organized into collective farms called kolkhozes. they came through these first years of hardship on the steppe. Against all odds, having grown crops, built homes, and established schools, the community began to believe their troubles were behind them. They were wrong. A new state directive ordered that all Korean language schools and institutes be shut down. And to prevent the language from being taught, the textbooks that the Koreans brought with them in the deportation were burned.
Надо это подчеркнуть. Если бы тогда не закрыли бы, вся корейская семья бы, конечно, корейский язык сохранились бы, и русский язык бы позже на войну учились бы, потому что сейчас уже мне возникает сильно обидно, как нации корейцев хотели, поселили бы в то время даже в Сибири, где мороз достигает минус до 30, до 50 градусов, наверное, как нации, наверное, не выжились бы.
If you had to define the Koryo Saram's response to their burden under the Soviet regime, words like dependable and willing come to mind. They had been forcibly relocated and did not resist, ordered to farm barren land and made it flourish, forbidden their mother tongue and stayed silent. Yet the government branded the Koryo Saram unreliable people, and they were not allowed to travel out of their farming towns.
When World War II broke out, many Koreans, men who had previously served with distinction in the Soviet army, were designated enemies of the state. They were not permitted to serve in the fight against Japan and Germany. Instead, they were taken to work in the labor armies, such as the mining camps of Karaganda.
До окончания войны очень трудно было. Наши вот эти ровесники, которые вместе мобилизовали тут армию, даже, наверное, 50% даже не вернулись. Вот на моем возрасте остались только двое. Сейчас я читаю. Я выжил, честно говоря, я выжил только благодаря матери, мама моя, я один остался. Для этого матери это ничем не читали. Сама она колядовала, ко мне вот это собрали колоски риса.
The Koryo Saram celebrated the simple act of survival. The Soviet state only recognized that Koreans were succeeding at the cultivation of rice in Kazakhstan. Their success was even hailed in propaganda films of the period, as in this film about a Korean kohols called Avant-Garde.
Мансама убрала с каждого гектара по 732 пуда риса. В третьем году по 976 пудов. Мировой рекорд. Примите мой привет и благодарность Красной Армии, товарищ Ким Мансам, за вашу заботу о бронетанковых силах, писал в своей телеграмме товарищ Сталин.
Да, после военный период уже работали так, день и ночь, надо сказать, серьезно. Тогда уже вот присвоенники, да, это указ были, поэтому работали очень хорошо. Поэтому вот эти все караташки долины, которые колхозы, все отличились от это, вот это казахские, вот маленькие колхозы. Поэтому это район, считаю, что тогда больше всех населения корейцев были.
The official Soviet policy towards its ethnic groups was contradictory. Korean language schools had been banned, but in order to herald its multi-ethnic population to the world, the government produced a Korean language newspaper, which as time went on, fewer and fewer people could read.
This newspaper was distributed to all Korean kolkhozes. Sometimes the head of kolkhoz subscribed just 200 copies, but threw it away. It was just wasting, because nobody could read it.
In a further irony, the Soviet regime maintained the Korean theater that had been launched in Vladivostok before the deportation. Now based in Ushtobe, but allowed to travel, the theater provided a vital link between the remote Korean kolkhozes and helped to keep some vestige of Korean music, dance, and language alive. However, the message of the performances was increasingly controlled by the state. There was a requirement that the majority of the productions were Russian or Soviet works. Only 10% of the repertoire could be traditional Korean plays.
В тот период, это при той системе, как бы все было цензура, да? Это нельзя петь, это можно петь.
Яков Кан was a musical director of the theater during the Soviet era.
У меня была запись южнокорейских песен. Я чувствую красивую мелодию, красивую гармонию. Я говорю, почему бы не исполнить, да? Мы, короче, я взял на свой страх и риск, включил ее в программу. И на следующий день же меня на ковер вызывают, весь худсовет. Так, кто тебе дал разрешение? Да, исполнит. Вот. Поэтому... Я честно скажу, я в слезах вышел после этого.
Ultimately, the theater became a source of both great pride and great pain.
In the Soviet time, all the politics were directed toward the development of the standard person, Homo Sovieticus. The outside was left looking ethnic, but everyone had to share the same core, including the language, the Russian language.
Старики, с горечью вспоминают они дни своей юности, проведенные в стране утренней свежести Кореи, порабощенной тогда японскими милитаристами. Старики сравнивают свою загубленную молодость со свободной и радостной жизнью на советской земле, земле, согретой лучами сталинской конституции.
Many Koreans would have leapt at the chance to return to their homeland. At the time, however, they were denied the right to travel within their own region, let alone travel abroad. When Korea became divided in 1945, and North Korea came under the Soviet influence, a few hundred Soviet Koreans were sent to Pyongyang as technical advisors to the new regime. But the North Korean leader, Kim Il-sung, did not trust the Soviet Koreans. And by the late 1950s, they were forced to return to the Soviet Union. With no other option, the Koryo Saram gradually melded into the Soviet model and worked to survive and succeed in the terms of the times.
The death of Stalin in 1953 was a big event in the history of Soviet Union, and it was also watershed in the history of Koryo Saram, because they gained freedom and equality in the post-Stalin era.
For the first time since 1937, the Koryo Saram were free to choose where and how they lived in Kazakhstan. Many moved into cities, even into professional careers. Dekabrina Kim, who was banished with her family in the remote provinces, had a 47-year career in medicine, first as a doctor and then as chief general practitioner for her region. While many Koreans joined Dekabrina Kim in the move to the cities, others stayed and worked on the farms. In 1954, Stalin's successor Nikita Khrushchev made the production of food an urgent priority and introduced his Virgin Lands project. He opened up vast areas of empty territory in Kazakhstan. Hundreds of thousands of people from all over the Soviet Union arrived to work the land. Korean farms were consolidated into larger cooperative farms called sovkhozes and became a part of the Virgin Lands project.
Тут приезжал Тимошак Метович. Вот этот фотографию. Сняли на рысу плантации нашего колхоза, сапоза, то есть. В 1982 году.
Сергей Юн became the director of one of the most successful farms in Kazakhstan.
Чем первый получил пятилетки, когда я стал работать, это трудовое красное знание. Потом следующие пятилетки показатели тоже хорошие были. Мне представили, я получил орден Ленина.
He now lives in Almaty with his children and grandchildren. He helps his son Alexander run a successful import-export business, selling everything from car batteries to cabbage.
Это корейский капуст. Я семена привез из Южной Кореи. Мы посадили вот у штоби в хозяйстве есть. Там выросли, сюда привез. Мы сейчас очищаем, вывозим на базары, по заказу вывозим, люди закупают. Поэтому я должен сказать, очень дешево.
Although Sergei Yun has planted seeds he brought from South Korea to grow traditional cabbages, the kimchi housewives make from those cabbages is pickled and spiced in the flavors of Kazakhstan. The diversity of those flavors is an unusual legacy of Stalin's ethnic policy toward Kazakhstan. The dumping ground has become the melting pot. Uzbek nut vendors, Kazakh camel's milk, Russian honey, Kazakh meats, Uyghur noodles, and of course Korean kimchi all come together on the market floor. The ethnic core has proven more resilient than the crumbling Soviet model in which the Koryo Saram survived for 70 years. I wanted to see how they have lived on. On the surface, little has changed in Ustobe since the upheaval of the Soviet collapse and Kazakh independence. It is still a quiet farming village. Kazakh warriors have overtaken the town square, while Marx and Lenin have retreated to an obscure spot in the woods. That symbolic changing of the guard is mirrored in the fields, where private enterprise has replaced the collective farms, and modern machinery has reduced the need for manual labor. Once the capital of the Korean diaspora in Kazakhstan, Ustobe is now home to many Kazakhs, Russians, Chechens, and Kurds. I was invited to a Koryo Saram wedding. I was struck by how some of the old Korean customs have survived in an almost unrecognizable form. A chicken is presented to the bridal party, and a bag of rice is placed at the doorstep. These men, representing the bride's and groom's families, are playing out an age-old ritual, debating the quality of the drink for the wedding as a measure of one family's respect for another. These customs were new to me. Ironically, it was the forced isolation of the Koryo Saram that allowed for the preservation of their Korean village culture. Here at this proudly old-fashioned wedding, Koryo Saram mixed with Kazakhs, Russians, and Chechens, in person, in food, and in ceremony. Even the bride and groom are only part Korean. As I celebrated with these guests, I felt the intensity of their communal bond based on their shared history. But I also felt that I was watching a vanishing way of life. For many Koryo Saram, the freedom to choose a new path begins with life in Almaty, Kazakhstan's largest city. Kazakhstan's huge oil and mineral reserves are fueling an economic boom, which is leading to rapid change. The streets are jammed with Japanese and European cars. The signs of globalization are everywhere. In the shadow of the old guard, I can buy old Soviet medals for spare change, the same medals that cost Sergei Yun a lifetime of back-breaking work. But the freedom to choose a new path comes at a real cost, especially to those who lived longest under the old regime.
Мы все, вот, которые сидим здесь, родились и выросли при советской власти. И сбрасывать со счетов эти годы, 70 лет, мы не в состоянии, не можем.
СССР, когда социализм строил, они фактически разбили язык не только корейцев, а всех наций, народностей, которые проживали в бывшем Советском Союзе.
Национальную принадлежность человека определяет язык, на котором он мыслит.
Да,
правильно. Да. Это не гречанка.
Это тюрист. Вот.
А практически мы мыслим русским, но сами
это,
я говорю, я...
Это наш менталитет уже такой, что это вот корейцы,
мы
тоже
мы
отличаемся. Друзья, мы не корейцы, не русские и не казахи.
В общем, нейтральный. Так, дело не в этом. Вот смотрите,
мы корейцы.
Если говорить о языке...
Like spirits doomed to roam the steppe, unanswered questions of nationality continue to trouble many first and second generation Korean Kazakhs.
Здесь мой дедушка Гейбону, ученый-просветитель, который сделал, на мой взгляд, довольно большой вклад в борьбе не только за независимость, но и в борьбе за образованность корейского населения, попавшего в силу жизненных обстоятельств на территорию России.
Гейбону would have no problem thinking of himself as Korean. For his grandson, Николай Гей, who directs an organization dedicated to Koryo Saram heroes, the question is more difficult.
Вот сейчас с дистанции времени я уже проанализировал достаточно глубоко, и я понял, что система, в которой мы росли, развивались, и, казалось бы, мы были счастливы, сейчас я уже проанализировав, могу сказать, что, может быть, пускай бы мы жили хуже. Я вообще считаю, что нас обокрали в этом плане. Ограбили, так сказать. Тут.
Grappling with Kazakhstan's painful history is not unique to the Koryo Saram. Many of Kazakhstan's 130 different ethnic groups were displaced from their homelands and forced to relocate here during the Soviet era. They are now recalling what was lost during those years. Even the Kazakhs, the majority ethnic group, are looking back for something they can call their own. This National Day festival is one of the first large-scale events to celebrate Kazakh culture, which, along with their language, was repressed during the Soviet years. The Russian language now shares the stage with Kazakh, which has been declared the official language and is being learned by all Kazakhs.
I'm very glad that Almaty is a multinational city. When I began to attend the university, I made many Korean friends. But before, most of my friends, they were Kazakh and Russian. It's not a problem for us, like, it doesn't matter what nation you are. We just socialize because of our interests. I always knew that I was Korean. Unfortunately, in our family, we don't speak Korean. We speak Russian. I choose my major, Korean, because I would like to learn Korean and to go to Korea and to see how people live there.
For this young generation of Koryo Saram, rediscovery of their Korean ancestry has become a welcome opportunity.
По которой я сюда поступила, это мой папа. Потому что он, как приверженец истинно корейской культуры, хотел, чтобы я знала, как он выразился, родной язык.
When it was Soviet Union, yes, many people, they tried to be Russian, like maybe inside. But now everyone tries to recall his own history. That's why now we began to learn our own language.
Machine,
The Korean language never completely disappeared. Spoken a little by elders and the Korean theater, a connection back to the motherland remained. In fact, linguists have flocked to Kazakhstan to study the Koryo Saram language, an archaic dialect that was thought to be extinct. Ironically, the Koryo Saram dialect is now more threatened than ever.
В последнее время как-то мы начали изучать корейский язык, потому что как открыли дорогу это с югом. Тогда только начали сейчас изучать грамоту, там, язык. А в общем, до этого у нас мы были закрыты, вообще не знали корейский язык. Ну, говорили бытовой язык, который наши бабушки это в древние говорили.
Even the TV program called Koryo Saram employs a South Korean to narrate the news, which today is about the mayor of Seoul's visit to Kazakhstan.
오찬석에서 이명박 서울시장은 손님으로서 환대의 경의를 표하며 카자흐스탄에서 조국의 역사로부터 멀리 떨어져 살아온 고려인 소수 민족의 단결력과 우애 그리고 카자흐스탄 고려인들이
감사합니다.
These days, the wind blows strongly from South Korea. Korean corporations do a lot of business in Kazakhstan, and some Koryo Saram have been able to travel there. You can understand the temptation some Koryo Saram have to adopt this bright and successful culture as their own. But for others, these outside pressures are just one more threat to their cultural survival.
Но последнее время, вот я сейчас ему говорил, у нас какой-то раскардаш получился с южными корейцами. Вот эти миссионеры на похоронах вдруг совсем по-другому начинают нам говорить, что вот так нельзя, не надо, вот так надо.
Это видишь, у них христианская вера, да, ты видишь. А то, что мы проводим, да, теорию рангау, это шаманство, понимаешь?
Я поэтому так, иногда, я говорю, кто тут будет, вот там будет, я говорю, не надо тут, сейчас начнется тут, понимаешь, свистопляска, как у нас шло по традиции, тут, так, давайте так и проводить будем.
Стопа!
Этого я больше всего боюсь.
This traditional Korean ceremony is held on the first birthday of each child. He's presented a number of objects to choose from. His selection will suggest what kind of career his future promises. I'm not sure what the mobile phone represents, but I am certain the boy himself symbolizes a complex future. His costume was purchased in South Korea. His father is Koryo Saram, and his mother is a Russian Kazakh. What traditions will his generation bring with them in the future?
Дух корейский, конечно, существует, потому что национальные эти обычаи, потом еда наша, да, потом эти обычаи, все равно оставляет дух корейский.
Ой, как хорошо. Ой. Вот, как мне кажется, это только дополняет нашу семью с этой стороны, с другой стороны. Мы настолько дополняем друг друга вот этими всеми традициями, учимся друг у друга и только богаче от этого становимся.
Когда мы поехали в Корею, в Южную Корею поехали, конечно, щемило сердце, что это корейцы, мы везде вокруг корейцы, это Корея, это как бы там историческая родина или что. Но когда мы сели в самолет обратно и заиграл казахский вальс, мы заплакали. Вот теперь я не знаю, что это родина, да? Наверное, все-таки Казахстан.
As the Koryo Saram embrace their new nationality, their distinct culture has changed. It is a sense of loss that motivates musician Yakov Khan. He is traveling throughout Kazakhstan and neighboring countries in search of elders.
В данное время сейчас я занимаюсь проектом по выпуску сборника музыкальных произведений. Это наших предков, которые были депортированы в 1937 году. как бы говорят, без прошлого нет будущего, поэтому этот сборник как будет, будет являться каким-то памятником для будущих поколений.
О, здравствуйте, Владимир Иванович.
Здравствуйте.
О, Владимир Иванович, здравствуйте.
Здравствуйте.
Ой, бабуль, как
здоровье?
Нормально. Я всегда как бы прошу, чтобы именно как они слышали в детстве, да, или там учили, именно вот этого.
Как называется песня третья?
Саранханун пумотонгсен мадунавасу Куриптон иея индеванюня Пангаон моксариро сонмугл жапко Таксурие камцан нолакео навони Пангаон моксаринан кангоди опко Хамухада намдонг илтонг налсогио конна.
Ой, спасибо.
That place of glad voices is nowhere to be found. The Koryo Saram are discovering that the idea of homeland is elusive. So what makes their story any different from those of immigrants and refugees around the globe? Shedding identities like old skins as they embrace new lives and opportunities. The Koryo Saram never chose to give up their culture. They held on to it with resilience. Now they travel forward with this heritage as a reminder of their origin, just as the songs Yakov Khan records are echoes of the ghost trains and beyond.
Oh.